hearts are open, all desires known and from you, no secrets are hidden. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord.
Amen. St. Paul to the Galatians. Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus, by the will of God, and Timothy, our brother, to the saints and faithful brothers and sisters in Christ in Colossae, grace to you and peace from God our Father. In our prayers for you, we always thank God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, for we have heard of your faith in Christ Jesus and of the love that you have for all the saints because of the hope laid up for you in heaven. You have heard of this hope before in the word of the truth, the gospel that has come to you, just as it is bearing fruit and growing in the whole world, so it has been bearing fruit among yourselves from the day you heard it and truly comprehended the grace of God. This you learned from Epaphras, our beloved fellow servant. He is a faithful minister of Christ on your behalf, and he has made known to us your love in the Spirit. For this reason, since the day we heard it, we have not ceased praying for you and asking that you may be filled with the knowledge of God's will in all spiritual wisdom and understanding, so that you may lead lives worthy of the Lord, fully pleasing to him, as you bear fruit in every good work and as you grow in the knowledge of God. May you be made strong with all the strength that comes from this glorious power, and may you be prepared to endure everything with patience, while joyfully giving thanks to the Father, who has enabled you to share in the inheritance of the saints in the light. He has rescued us from the power of darkness and transferred us into the kingdom of his beloved Son, in whom we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins. Hear what the Spirit is saying to God's people.
Thanks be to God.
Took care of him. The next day, the Samaritan took two denarii, gave them to the innkeeper, and said, take care of him. When I come back, I will repay you whatever more you spend. Jesus asked the lawyer, which of these three do you think was a neighbor to the man who fell into the hands of the robbers? The lawyer said, the one who showed him mercy. Jesus said to him, go and do likewise. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Please pray with me the prayer of mission. Gracious
and loving God, help us to say, to understand, and celebrate the beginning of the world, to be transformed in Jesus' love, and to use our gifts to make a difference for others. Amen.
Please be seated. It's Sunday morning, a little past 10 on the Lord's Day. You're in God's house. Other people are where you might be later at farmer's market looking beautiful flowers. Maybe like me, going to the grocery store, shopping for essentials, frosted flakes, whipped cream. But you're here in God's house on the Lord's Day, mere mortals seeking immortality. I think that's existentially very cool. Mere mortals seeking immortality. That's what we're doing together today. The lawyer says, how may I inherit eternal life? He gets the question absolutely wrong. He gets it wrong because he's looking for loopholes about how to inherit eternal life as if it's just a matter of luck. But God, who is pure act, who has no potentiality, but is actus, plurals, pure act, he acts for you. He acts for you in the sacrament. You'll soon receive his body and blood. He acts for you in with another, the bread and the wine. The medicine of immortality, St. Ignatius of Antioch writes, when he's being led to his martyrdom, he writes to the church in Ephesus and calls this sacrament that you're about to receive in your mouth, the body and blood of Christ, his real presence, the medicine of immortality, God acting for you on this table. Actos puros, pure act, God for you. You mere mortals seeking immortality. So the lawyer did too. But he gets things wrong. And let's investigate how wanting to inherit eternal life and showing mercy, we often get it wrong because we are, as Lutherans will remind you, by nature sinful and unclean. Sorry. Don't hear that much these days, but now we're going to hear it a little bit because we're going to see how we try to do mercy, but we will fall short and we'll depend on one whose mercy is perfect. You may guess who that is. But let's look at how sometimes the world frustrates us, how we turn inwards, what happens when we try to deal with mercy. I'll give you an example from fiction. It's a fictional character, so I'm not going to pick on anybody. See if you can guess who it is. This fictional character only speaks French, was developed about 1818 by a young woman, 19 years old. This fictional character learns mercy by watching the DeLacy family through a crack in the wall. DeLacy family is an old blind man and his son and daughter, and they love each other so much. They have literature and philosophy, and they read, and they sit by the fire, and they take care of each other, and they cook meals, and they don't have much money, but the mercy is there, such wonderful mercy. And this fictional character learns of that mercy, and his heart is filled. And he will go out at night and gather firewood for the DeLacy family and bring it and put it in their wood pile. So every morning they wake up, and they think a friendly spirit has replenished their firewood, so they can sit around the fire and study and read and love each other and show mercy. And his first words to society at large are, pardonnez-moi, monsieur, je suis un voyageur, un monde de repos. I am a traveler I spend a few moments before the fire. Who is this fictional character?
Voilà le monstre, Frankenstein.
Frankenstein's Monster, written by Mary Shelley, 1880. He started out as a nice guy, right? Or parts of nice guys. But as humanity was split open, stitched together, he finally goes within himself. Because people see his outside and they judge him and they hate him and they try to kill him. And he's filled with vengeance. He turns, in Cervantes would say, inside himself, which is a term for sin. He turns within himself and he seeks vengeance on all the world, even vengeance on his creator, Dr. Victor Frankenstein. We too can go out in the world filled with thoughts of mercy. We'll leave here, go and do likewise, as Jesus observes for the lawyer to do. And we get frustrated and angry because maybe we're misjudged. Maybe we're seen as monstrous in some way. We're prejudged. We get our feelings hurt. We get frustrated. We're passed over for promotion. Who knows what it is, but we start turning in on ourselves and we become pieces of humanity instead of a whole humanity. We become monstrous, perhaps, in our thought and our jealousy and our competitiveness and our envy. That sad, slow, sad, strange anger Augustine calls envy. We're filled with envy, revenge, frustration. So that might be one way where we fail in our mercy. But let's look at the lawyer, because he really gets things right and he gets things wrong. He comes to Jesus today to test Jesus. Don't test Jesus. I've tried it and it's ugly, so don't. And it doesn't work out well for the lawyer either. The lawyer comes cynically to Jesus. I don't know why he's cynical. He comes from a good home, obviously well-educated. Educated in the faith as well. He knows the Ten Commandments. Love God with your whole self, your neighbor as yourself. But he comes, maybe he studied the ancient Greek cynics, Heraclitus and Diogenes. The rabbis could have taught him that, part of the learning from ancient Greece. But he comes cynically to Jesus and he asks him a cynical question. This is where I get my idea for this. He says, how do I inherit eternal life? And in ancient Greek, inherit means sticks and stones used in gambling games. Like we throw dice. How can I throw dice and luck into the kingdom of God? So right away, Jesus knows he's got a problem. So Jesus, being a wonderful teacher, he does some wonderful techniques here. He goes, smarty pants, you know the law. What is it? You know what it is. And the lawyer answers right away. Boom, 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 boom. Goes right through it. Love God with your whole self, love your neighbor as yourself. And Jesus says, do this and you'll live. Then I imagine him walking off. Jesus often walked off in his teaching. It's called attractive withdrawal. He will teach a parable, like the seeds on the road, in the weeds, on the rocks, fertile soil. And then he withdraws. And then his disciples, the 18, people are really interested, they'll go, oh, where's he going? And they'll follow him and say, well, what's that parable mean? And they'll go, well, sit down, I'll teach you. And then he teaches people who are really interested. So today, rhetorically, or in a speech-making fashion, he says to the lawyer, oh, yeah, well, do this and then you'll live. And the lawyer follows him, but he trips as he follows him. He says, well, who are my neighbors then? It's like St. Peter saying, well, how many times should I forgive people? Like, seven times? And Jesus goes, no, 77 times seven. Right? That's Jesus. I mean, he's just too much sometimes, right? So the lawyer says, well, who's my neighbor? And you know, I make the same mistake. Even the amazing pastor. I make the same mistake. It is really. I make the same mistake as the lawyer. Because I often think of the neighbors as out here. Like, who's my neighbor? Well, is it just my Lions Club? Is it just the people at St. Paul's? I kind of like them. You know, is it who's my neighbor out here? And Jesus is going to say, it's not the guy in the road that's the neighbor. Like, I think, well, I have to help my neighbor because it's the guy in the road that got wounded and robbed. No, Jesus is going to teach the lawyer that you're the neighbor wherever you go. So you're the neighbor. Wherever you go, you have to be the neighbor. The Samaritan is a neighbor to the guy in the ditch, but you'll notice the Samaritan is also the neighbor to the innkeeper, isn't he? He says, you're going to take care of this guy, please, and anything you spend over what I've given you, these two denarii, I'll resupply you. So go ahead and take care of this guy as much as you can, and I'll be the neighbor to you too, innkeeper. So wherever we go, we have to turn outwards from ourselves, and we have to see the other, but we need to be the neighbor to whomever we meet. Like, love your enemies. Again, Jesus, come on, right? Love your enemies. We need to love our enemies, people we disagree with, people who hate us. We need to love them. Gee, man. So we have to be neighbor and be going outwards. So you can see the lawyer gets it right, and he gets it wrong at the same time. He gets it right because he goes, the one who showed mercy. And this is the fine point where I stress that I know you're going to go out and you're going to be merciful and I know you're going to fail. Just people being people. Humans being humans. Right? I'm going to fail too. The lawyer gets it right and the lawyer gets it wrong in the same instance. He says, the one who shows mercy, what doesn't he say? He doesn't say the Samaritan who showed mercy. Why? Because the Jews don't like the Samaritans, and the Samaritans don't like the Jews. It all has to do with the Babylonian captivity, where some Jews were taken off to Assyria, and they developed their idea of Jewishness, and then the Samaritans were left behind, they developed their idea of Jewishness, and then when they get together, they're going to fight about it. So the lawyer, when he says, the one who showed mercy, isn't showing mercy, because he doesn't say the Samaritan who showed mercy. That same kind of thing, don't we? We go through that same kind of thing. So that's our human dilemma. You, mere mortals, who are seeking immortality, where do we find the perfect mercy? And it's in the medicine of immortality. It's in the mercy of God, because God acts for you here. Right? It's not that we love God, but God first loved us and gave his Son as an expiation for our sin. God is active. God is for you. If God is love, God has to communicate. So he communicates to you through his Son, through the Holy Spirit, through Scripture. Praise be through sermons based on Scripture. And Jesus acts for you in with and under the bread of the vine, through the divine power, through his promise, simply saying, this is, not coulda, woulda, shoulda, coulda, mighta, was once a long time ago. But right here, right now, this is my body. This is my blood in the new covenant. It is your medicine for the resurrection. God always works that way. God so loved the world, it wasn't so much loved the world, but God loved the world so, hotus gar in Greek, God loved the world so, he gave his only Son for you, that you believing in him, you not perish as mere mortals, but have eternal life, immortality by grace, through faith in God's word. This is my body. This is my blood. So, here we are, mere mortals. Let's end with a prayer. It's 9 words, easy peasy. Some of you might pray it for the first time, this prayer. Some of you might pray it for the 12,000th time. Well, let's bow our head, repeat after me this prayer. Our great hope, our great joy, as St. Paul said. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy. Confess the Nicene Creed together. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being the Father, through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again. In accordance with the Scriptures, he ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Let us pray for the church and for the world. Grant, Almighty God, that all who confess your name may be united in your truth, live together in your love, and reveal your glory in the world. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Guide the people of this land and of all the nations in the ways of justice and peace, that we may honor one another and serve the common good. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Give us all a reverence for the earth as your own creation, that we may use its resources rightly in the service of others and to your honor and glory. Lord, in your mercy, bless all whose lives are closely linked with ours, and grant that we may serve Christ in them and love one another as he loves us. Lord, in your mercy, comfort and heal all those who suffer in body, mind, or spirit. Give them courage and hope in their troubles, and bring them the joy of your salvation. We pray especially for Giddy Anderson, Margaret Aubrey, Brock, Cindy Bodenlos, Ann George, Tayana Fabe, Dylan Gura, Alexander Hopkins, David Kosnick, Ketch Ryan, Larry Margulis, Dare Mikos, John Miller, Sharon B., Mary Jo Schwan, and Lisa Strebing. The people of Ukraine, the people of Russia, the people of Afghanistan, and the people all over our nation and throughout the world who have most recently suffered gun violence. Lord, in your mercy, we commend to your mercy all who have died, that your will for them may be fulfilled. And we pray that we may share with all your saints in your eternal kingdom. Lord, in your mercy.
Almighty and eternal God, ruler of all things in heaven and earth, mercifully accept the prayers of your people and strengthen us to do your will through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. Jesus Christ. Strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Let's share this peace. Do you know the only one who got the quiz on the fictional character was Yu-Gi-Oh? She knows her 19-year-old authors. Mary Lucy Shelley.
Thank you.
Lord our God. Before time you made ready the creation, your spirit moved over the deep and brought all things into being, sun, moon, and stars, earth, wind, and waters, and every living thing. You made us in your image, male and female, and taught us to walk in your ways. But we rebelled against you and wandered far away. And yet, as a mother cares for her children, you would not forget us. Time and again, you called us to live in the fullness of your love. And so this day, we join with saints and angels in the chorus of praise that rings through eternity, lifting our voices to magnify you as we sing. Again, as supper was ending, Jesus took the cup of wine. Again, he gave thanks to you, gave to them, and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood in the new covenant, which is poured out for you and for all for the forgiveness of sin. Whenever you drink of it, do this for the remembrance of me." That they may be the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. Breathe your spirit over the whole earth and make us your new creation, the body of Christ given for the world you've made. In the fullness of time, bring us, with all your saints, from every tribe and language and people and nation, to feast at the banquet prepared for the foundation of the world. through Christ and in Christ and with Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, to you be all honor, glory, and praise, forever and ever. Please stand. Let us pray. Eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior Jesus Christ, and you have fed us with spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now to the world of peace and grant us strength. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon your favor and give you his peace.